like every day is the same. What I'm worried about is this. We're going to have fishermen without receipts. We're going to have fishermen without our IRS filings. We're going to have fishermen who maybe are not that literate. They fished all of their lives. They earn a living for their families and the villages that they live in. But they're not the kind of structured business people that you could say, I want your audited receipts in order to prove that you are eligible for this claim. What alternatives do you have?
Mr. Jones, you're a fisherman. Come in and have your ship captain tell me what he paid you. I don't need documentation. Have your ship captain come. Have your priest come in and verify. I need some corroboration, some proof. I don't need extensive business records. I've got to prove. You've got to demonstrate that you have a valid claim. But I will bend over backwards to try and find eligibility.
Will you define this in your protocols?
Yes.
So that was California Congresswoman Maxine Waters questioning Ken Feinberg in congressional hearings on the Hill on Wednesday. Joining us now to start the conversation about what Feinberg's up against, Mike Papantonio, GRITtv's Gulf correspondent and co-host of Ring of Fire. Mike's working on behalf of some of those bringing suits against BP. Mike, to you on this question of what we know about Feinberg so far and what he's facing. Let's start with what we know about him. He worked for the 9/11 Victims Fund, the dispute resolution part of the Gulf Road Home program. Now he's heading up this fund. What do you think he's up against, and is he up to the task?
I'm not down on Feinberg. I just want everybody to understand, Feinberg is not Mother Teresa. He's come out with this image of you know, he's there for the victims. He really isn't there for the victims. You can't miss this. BP pays his salary. BP pays his bonus. BP is flying him around in a BP jet all over the coast to try to make this sound like everything is just okay. While BP does that, you have this other theme going on, and that is, just come to me, I'm going to treat you better than the court system is. Well, that's ridiculous. It's on this very face is ridiculous. Imagine a setting where you've been injured. You've lost your entire livelihood for the next 10 years. Now, the person who's going to decide how much you're going to be paid is the BP lawyer who caused the catastrophe to begin with. And you also have to understand that the person joining this conversation is a person that has this history of not playing fair, of being a felon, not Feinberg, but the company that he's speaking for. This company that he speaks for that says that is telling him, I'm sure, that they want to be fair. We have not seen fairness. We've seen a company that's been had to plead to felonies. They've had to plead to fines, $350 million in fines for price fixing. We've seen them time after time where they have simply ignored the rules. They don't have a moral compass. And that's what we have to look at. When we look at Feinberg, we have to say Feinberg is the voice for this company that we learned 2 weeks ago was implemental in having one of the most having a terrorist released so BP could drill in Libya. So when we look at Feinberg, we have to look at BP. We have to keep that in mind.
There's another question here, though, too, also, Mike, which is, you know, usually with these compensation claims, whether you're talking Agent Orange or the uranium miners in the Southwest, the problem has been that people have waited too long for the compensation. It's been so slow a process. In this case, I'm concerned it's happening too fast. How can anybody assess the damage that this bill has caused?
They can't do it, Laura. First of all, let's not forget this either. There is no $20 billion in any fund anywhere in the world. It's not even in BP's bank account. I have to tell you that. This is a company that has said, look, Feinberg, you go out and you sell this pig in a poke. That's all it is right now. It's all it is we're going to take care of you. He's saying exactly the same thing that we see in the advertisements that we see on the front page of every paper in America.
So you mean there's no escrow fund? There's no $20 billion sitting in escrow somewhere?
Worse than that. There hasn't even been any securitization of this $20 billion. In a bankruptcy setting, they don't owe anybody anything. If they, there's something called a scheme in the British, in the UK, and the scheme's the same thing, is it's kind of a variation of our bankruptcy process. But if they invoke that, there's nothing that, there's no money that changes hands here at all. Look, this is very evident, Laura. It's very evident. This is a company that's trying to amortize or spread out the cost of this catastrophe that they've caused America. It's something that should be cleaned up. It should be over within 18 months. I know for a fact they've built in a plan to do it over 15 years. I also know that they're meeting with bankruptcy lawyers at the same time that they're telling us everything is okay. They're meeting with bankruptcy lawyers. I also know that this is a company that is struggling to even float a $10 billion bond setting. Two days ago, they got lucky and sold $7 billion worth of their assets to Apache. But it shows you this is a desperate company. They're so desperate that Moody's and Fitch's has downplayed and cut down their bonds to where it's almost a junk bond setting. So look, Feinberg can say what he wants to say. I've worked with Feinberg over the years. I've had some success with him. But if you talk to some of the people that have worked with him in an unsuccessful setting, he is not going to come out looking like Mother Teresa. And I'm not buying into it. And I'm one of the people that are negotiating with him on how this ought to flow to the victims. There's some things we agree with. If somebody has a claim, if they go to court and they say, look, my claim is, say, $50,000 over the next 5 years, and I know that I'm not going to have anything more than $50,000 or maybe even $60,000 over the next 5 years, that person shouldn't have a lawyer. That person doesn't need to pay a lawyer a dime. But what about a hotel where it's very complicated? What about a seafood industry that is a processor? It's very complicated. What about a bank, the commercial banks that are going out of business because of foreclosures along here on the coast? Is Feinberg going to say, yeah, I'm going to treat you fairly? Of course not. Look, we don't even know at this point whether Feinberg is getting a bonus according to how much of that $20 billion he shaves off. So look.
Ouch. Let me ask you one more thing, Mike. I mean, you mentioned the company in conversation with others about buying up their assets. I understand they're also in conversations with scientists about buying their silence. Is there any danger that they're buying up justices? And I know you're bringing a RICO case. What do you call it when you pay off the science?
Yeah, listen, what they're not just buying the scientists, where they're saying they're going to University of South Alabama, they're going all along the coast, these universities all along the coast. And here's what they're telling them. They're saying, first of all, if you find something bad, you can't publish your research. You can't share that bad finding with other scientists. You can't speak about that bad data in public for the next 3 years. As a matter of fact, they're offering these scientists. Some of them will be complete biostitutes. Bobby Kennedy and I work against them all the time. They simply prostitute for the right amount of money. Well, these people, they're going to go out and they're going to hire for, you know, to increase their livelihood by about $200,000 to $300,000 a year. So,
well, let's get this clear. They're going to underfunded public universities.
Exactly.
And saying,
exactly.
We'll underwrite your science department
that's
in exchange
exactly
for this
right.
kind of science.
Well, first of all, there's other problems with that. This is public money. Understand, most of this is taxpayer-based money that's going to that university. To have them pay, to have them do work that works against the best interest of taxpayers. There's a flaw with that on this very face. It's not only an ethical flaw, it's a legal flaw, because they're going to end up owning these laboratories, owning these research mechanisms, these research vessels that we pay for as taxpayers. So that will become part of my RICO case as this develops, absolutely.